Thunder Grunt Podcast Network.
What's up, man?
What?
You're not gonna come down and say hi to me? What's up with that dipshit? Huh?
Hi, Derek.
Whoa, calm down, man. I'm just joking. You guys, I really like your guys' setup here.
What's your problem, man?
My problem? I don't know. I don't have a problem, Dale. Actually, I have the opposite of a problem. I made over 550K last year.
How much did you make?
It's not about money.
No, it's not about money. Well, for me, it's a little bit about money.
And I made that much money last year. I am the VP of the biggest executive helicopter leasing company on the Western Seaboard, okay? I haven't had a cop since 2004. Check these out.
You see these? You see these, boys? This is what I live with every day. I lather this up with keels in the shower.
You wanna touch this? Huh? You wanna touch these bad boys?
Sorry, not gonna happen. Hit my 5.0, put my rag top down so my hair can blow. The girl is on standby, waiting just to say hi. Did you stop? No, I just drove by, kept on pursuing to the next stop. I bust a left and I'm heading to the next
stop. A small little ship in the center of Mars was a sack of souls with experiment scars. When a psychedelic monk said, I'll take two, and he put them in a rocket and he ate a lot of glue. And he shot them to Earth, and they turned into babies. They were named from that, and they really got rabies. And the monk made a movie of their whole entire lives. They were penned and obscene, then zooms of the thigh. And one time Bob had sex with a ladle, and one time Matt lost a vent to a cradle, and another time Bob caught a dinosaur mom, and another time Matt bought a replica of Guam. And all this more is on a DVD. He said only $20.99 with the purchase of a gym, but if you call right now and say, where's my whisk, we'll include this bonus disc.
Hey! Hey, how are you doing? I try to kill Matt at the opening of every show by just trying to scare the fuck out of him. Because we need to be woken up after this goddamn sleeping pill of a movie that we just watched. I'm Bob Rose. With me is my co-host, Matt P.A.
Yes.
And with us today is somebody I've been asking to be on this podcast for what, like...
And I get this movie!
I know! For as many times as I've asked you to be on here, we give you the shittiest movie. Tommy Sinbazo.
Hi,
thank
everybody.
You for coming, man.
How's it going?
All right. So, and Matt has been excited.
We've been skipping this movie for a month. Time Burst, the Final Alliance. It looks so good on the cover.
It looks awesome.
You've it's been unbelievably boring.
It's got a great font.
It's got that, everybody's...
That Asian actor from the 80s that's in a lot of stuff.
With the anti-Hitler mustache that's in everything.
Mm-hmm. The un-Hitler.
It looks...
Yeah.
Fun.
It looks fucking
incredibly
phenomenal.
Fun. It's by AIP Pictures,
which are
Action International Pictures.
Yeah. Before we start talking about
which
this
we
movie,
will be revisiting.
Yeah, we have to because this had two. This had the weirdest. All right, so this had one trailer for three movies in it, where it was a trailer for a movie, and then inexplicably the announcer just kind of segued into
and if
another trailer.
Like that, yeah. You might like this.
How about David Carradine with a robot arm from the future?
There's literally a Power Glove movie starring David Carradine.
Where he's a bounty hunter.
Yeah, with a Power Glove.
Yeah.
We just said that, and I'm going to tell you that it's nothing compared to the next movie.
Oh, no, God. It's not.
There's a movie called Sax Man. That is just, as far as the trailer tells you, is a man playing saxophone after doing everything, sex, murder, all of it. He's playing a
and
saxophone.
And starring the same dude who was in the other two movies.
Yeah, this, mm-hmm. I forgot his name now.
Frank
Gershwin.
You know.
It was like Frank Zamichello or some shit like that.
It was some long like name.
That. Some guy that sounds like he should be moving fish off of a truck.
You
mean old Joey, yeah.
That guy wasn't Joey in this Zax. Movie, and that's why they didn't care about this movie. Mm. They put all the good stuff in
this
Future
movie,
Force.
This movie was just there to get you to see the trailer for the other three movies.
We need a vehicle to deliver the trailer through VHS rentals. Go have a weekend and go shoot a
There weren't even breasts in this movie.
Nope.
There were no naked breasts. What's
dude,
it rated?
Hold on. This movie also is
we're gonna,
it's from a library. This is in a library.
St. Francis Library.
A library is a cultural center that one would visit to learn about where you are. You know what I mean? If I was like a refugee from somewhere I was in... Fucking that neighborhood, and I was like, I gotta learn about this culture, and I went, and this is what's on the
Did you pay...
No one on earth has ever heard of this movie. Why is it in a library?
Did you pay $6 for this?
Oh, hell no.
Oh, okay.
I got that for like 50 cents at a free market.
Well, you still got ripped
off. And it was... according to the inner cover, this video itself was last rented on March 1st, 2004.
That so somebody in 2004
got really excited.
Someone in 2004 rented this and was like, that's it. I'm switching to CDs. I'm a DVD guy now.
I didn't consider this, and on IMDb it doesn't say it, but this makes me think maybe the Final Alliance. Makes me think
there's
it could
another
be
another time burst.
Yeah, there could
no
be like
way.
Other time bursts.
There can't be. He's not. We'll get to it. But
I managed
be.
A video store for 5 years, and this was on the show.
Unless the first time burst is a
and
story.
I never watched it because it always looked awesome.
Yeah, is this a sequel?
That's what I'm saying. What
is the first one about the master? And
dude,
and his clan and what
this
happened
moves
to him?
Like a third sequel in a straight to VHS 90s series or whatever year this is. I didn't even look what year it was. It's probably 92 or something like that.
Let me see. I saw it earlier.
Either way, this might be one of the weirder movies to ever break down that we've ever done. Yeah. Like I say, Tommy, I said that to you before.
This
we had a lot of baffling stuff. This is like the most 1989. This is like a non-entity of a fucking movie.
This script could have been written by like a 12-year-old kid because of how like it's nonsense.
Yeah. I think this movie was so bad that I think they just used it as just to get the budget to funnel money to the Iran-Contra sort of thing. This was the government made this just to funnel funds
that's
to rebels.
It definitely feels like it was made for like the mafia or something. You know what I mean? Like they just need to move shit.
It's bad.
We need something to put on the outer sides of the truck so we can put shit in the middle. How about these fucking VHS tapes?
We made a whole movie. We made an entire movie so that we can produce enough VHS tapes to have a reason to fill a truck with them that then we could hide drugs.
Tell
in.
Me that didn't look like a movie that no one cared about.
If I was a kid and I had this movie.
The movie didn't care about that movie.
I would have left the first 10 minutes of this movie on the tape and then just recorded fucking Soul Train over it so I could jerk
you
off
know what?
Later.
If you took the first 10 minutes of this, edit directly to the
last
time burst cum shot scene, and then credits, this would be an awesome movie.
It's a great short film.
There's no bursting.
That's like
in
a
this.
Student film.
Hold
and
on.
There's no time
we'll get to it.
Okay.
We'll get to it. We'll get to it. Because I feel like breaking this down isn't that hard because so many scenes go on forever.
Yeah.
So,
but that's what's so great about it. That's what I kind of loved about it. Every time I want to like laugh. I'd be like,
oh my God. The ending. Okay, we'll talk about it. All right, so it starts out on that shot of the house of the 1,000 rooms.
Yes, which you don't know.
We don't know yet. It's just a house right now.
It looks like a barely built house.
No, it's a fucking shack.
It
kind of
looks
woods.
Like the house from the movie House.
It looks
except
worse than that.
Except if it's in the woods.
Oh, so,
I love
yes.
the house. It looks worse.
House is great. So, some dude in a suit walks up to the house.
Yes.
Right?
And then
the door
a
opens.
Samurai is standing there.
Old
and
samurai.
And it's the pudgy samurai
Anti-Hitler.
From the cover.
Yeah.
Right. Anti-Hitler. That's what we're calling him. He had
the
name.
Master. He was
He's
called,
the master.
He was called the master.
He's that guy. I forget his name.
Well, he looks like he could have been a bad guy in one
He's
of the...
He's Mace
like,
Bacon. We'll call him.
Like the three samurais.
Is someone in this movie's name Mace Bacon.
It's a real name. An actor's name.
That
so
person
good.
Might be alive.
We gotta meet Mace Bacon.
Mace Bacon.
Can you sign my copy of Time Burst? Dude, that guy like, would just fucking have an aneurysm.
This, he's like, my marriage ended over this.
Yeah. Or he has, or the
my
other way.
My wife send you. Is this like a sick joke? It's 2016. Brenda, you bitch.
Or he has the poster of this up in his living room when he brings women over. Oh, I see you noticing the movie I was in.
Oh, man, Mace Bacon. I bet he's got game with a name like
yeah,
Mace
you
Bacon.
Have to. Everybody loves Bacon.
He's like a
50s
superhero.
That's his line.
Yeah. Okay.
Have a
so,
BLT.
Reverse Hitler comes out of the door, and they both stare at each other for an inordinately long amount of time.
They don't say a word, but the guy in the suit hands him a tablet. You thought it was like a counterfeit
money plate. I thought it was
going to
be a...
Yeah, you automatically assumed it was counterfeit.
Because it's an 80s movie and like counterfeiting or drugs. It's like those are the two things I always assume is the plot.
For a movie made in 1989, it feels like it was made in like 1982 or
it does.
Yeah. You know what I mean? It's like crazy.
It's like it was on the shelf for a while or something.
It was back before movies had license to play actual songs.
Right. So
somebody probably should have told the people who made this movie that music is important when filming
anything.
So there's almost no music unless it's like a transition.
Dude, the amount of silence.
It's sick. It's sick.
The sick thing
it's
is, like, who, it makes you have to think about what's happening. Like, oh no, we should leave it silent so they can really absorb.
It makes you think, like, is this supposed to be funny?
There's action sequences with no music playing, and you're like, am I worried? Am I happy? Am I anything? Is everything okay?
It's depressing. It makes you just stare at people like when they're hitting
each
other.
We're going to get to a scene that will explain, why you couldn't put music on.
He hands him the tablet of
he gives
of
him
destiny
the
or whatever the fuck it is. God. And then we cut to the
airplane
sequence.
This guy gets out of a car, says something he could have wrote on a piece of
paper.
Matt
is not boiling it down. It's like some dude gets out of a car, talks to some people.
It's the guy. It's the same guy with the tablet.
Yeah,
we didn't notice it at first, though.
Yeah,
it's the same guy with the tablet. He gets out of a car. He gives the most bullshit last minute, like, I'm getting on a plane and I'm busy
feed my fish.
Don't forget to feed my fish, and you're in charge. I don't know why I waited until you got out of a car next to a fucking airplane at midnight.
I really wanted to see this fish story arc complete.
You did.
I did.
My money's on it being dead.
Yeah, those fish are the secret.
I wish it was. Like, that guy shows back up and he's like, what
the end of the movie, they start fuck. All right, damn it. All right, wait. They start fucking in the grass, but then it's like fucking Star Wars with ghosts, but it's like a fish in a bowl. Another ninja guy.
And the music finally rises.
Yeah.
And they just watch him fuck.
Didn't feed the fish. So yeah, he gets in a plane, and it seems like an insignificant. It seems like a travel sequence in an 80s movie. He gets in a plane, he starts talking to the most insignificant looking dude flying the plane. And the conversation is terrible.
Yeah,
he's like,
"Who are you? You're not Dave. Dave got sick really quick. I'm here now." And then
silence.
Yeah. And plane noise.
It's amazing.
Then he's like, "What? So what? What's,
so are you gonna take off?" He's like, "Yeah, everything's fine."
Yeah, and then you hear the control tower like, "Oh, you're not clear to take off."
And then
he just takes off anyway. Yeah,
he's like, "What's? Okay." Yeah, it's like it's so awkward.
Yeah.
It's like a 13-year-old trying to ask out somebody out for prom, but it's
like the engines start failing, and he's like, "Is everything okay?"
Oh, no, we're fine. I was talking. Did you say?
Did you ask me a question? Is there someone else in the plane?
Did you say something?
I just thought the scene was so insignificant. It turned out to be the most significant scene of the movie.
It's fucking crazy, and they're not doing anything. It's like a camera on in a room with two guys who don't know each other. It's super strange.
Like, if you just showed me that scene, I would assume it was candid. You know what? It doesn't seem like there's anyone acting. Just like,
it was just improv. The whole thing was go.
So then, you're an immortal warrior, but you don't know it. You're so what?
And go. We only have to play for 15 more minutes. Go.
Yeah, go. Hurry, they're coming.
There was a scene where there was inexplicably an alarm going off, but no one was responding to it. And we're like, did they break into this place to film? All right.
So then the guy, they're
just sitting there in silence. And then he goes, you know what? There might be a problem. And then he's like... Dude, I wish this was a British movie. Oh dear! It would seem there is a problem. There would be a problem.
It's Eddie Izzard. Like, what are you doing? Oh, I was just arranging these matches. Hello.
Did you need something? It's so good, man. These guys are giving each other nothing. And then the engine stops, and he's like, "Yeah, that's definitely a problem." Yeah, actually,
and the guy just says like.
They're
uh-oh.
In the air. They're
he's
in,
like,
yeah,
"Well, fly
yeah.
the plane, you idiot!" And he's like, "Oh, it's too late for that."
Yeah.
And what do you mean?
Do you have a family? Just I don't know.
In another movie with a better director, this could be an awesome scene where the guy's like, "Oh, it's you know, like you're enjoying the scene, like the fact I'm just gonna let this fucking thing crash."
Yeah, because
we have no idea that it's supposed to be funny.
Mm-hmm.
No,
it just seems tragically inept. It's like.
So, I do believe we're going to die.
Yeah, there's the shot of them going, oh!
And It's really
it's
good.
It's awesome. And then
it looks like they're flying into like a time warp or something, right? No, it's like remember the whole screen starts flashing white and they're like,
no, I thought
It looked like they were trying to say that the view from the plane was spinning, but they're just going
they're just
straight down.
Yeah. But it looked like the tape was actually malfunctioning.
Yeah,
yeah,
we watched
this
on VHS tape.
It looked like they were like warping through space.
I was like, it's the time burst. The
time burst. It's happening. Yeah.
That's what was affecting their minds. That's why they couldn't talk like humans. And then, so they crash. It explodes.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah, the plane just blows up. But then
the guy just comes running out of the plane.
This is my favorite. This might be my favorite scene in the movie because that's when it's just like
we were all like, "What the fuck is this?
What?" It does. It really. If you think about how it was edited together, it really makes less sense now.
Yeah.
Because the pilot gets out of the plane.
Yeah.
He crawls out. He's like kind of beaten up. But
he
he's still
running out.
Right.
Yeah.
He's still alive. And then out of the woods come these.
Yeah. Then it starts showing a bunch of samurais running out
of the woods.
But it
seems like he's looking at them.
Yeah. But he's not.
Because it shot at like the same location.
Yes.
It's nuts. And
yeah,
then
it looked like he crashed the plane, survived it, and then was about to get attacked in a samurai war.
Didn't you guys think
war.
That he, like, that was them going through the time burst and he landed in the past?
It
That's
was
what
easily...
I thought happened.
Oh.
That's what I assumed had happened.
Oh, you thought it was a Turtles in Time situation.
Right, he flew through a time warp.
I didn't even think about that.
No, and then it turned out to be not even remotely that.
No, yeah.
Absolutely not.
Turns out to be a flashback.
Yeah. But it's a flashback of him staring at an area, and then the area is the flashback.
It took like 3 or 4 different flashback sequences. You're like, oh, these are flashbacks.
Oh,
yes.
Because it's just a hard cut. It's not like a diddly-doo, none of that.
That's why I eventually asked you guys, is the dude in the mustache and the main character the same guy?
I didn't even notice until you said it.
Yeah, because I was like, are these flashbacks or another story being told? Is this like a time, like parallel universe movie?
It's actually, it's kind of wonderful how it doesn't even help you at all.
It doesn't help you at all.
Just convolutes everything.
Because he gets out, he's out of the plane, he's looking at the woods, and then we watch like, this really lame ass samurai fight is terrible.
It's really bad.
But it's
this guy with a weird mustache and like a cutlass versus a bunch of samurais. And then
at night, like you're watching candid footage again of a camcorder.
Yeah, you were like, ooh, LARPers.
I thought they were LARPing. Like the guy crash landed and people were still LARPing around him.
It looked like, and it's such it's just a wide shot too.
Dude,
it's a wide shot of the woods. it's not a film.
A lot of this movie is a wide shot of something with so little dressing on it that you feel like they had $100 to make this movie. You're like, oh wow, it's just a big long shot of that wood area.
Okay.
Nothing else.
It was a 48-hour film festival entry.
Yeah. That's all that really happened. They fight a little bit, and then we cut.
It's the old samurai guy.
The master.
The master
shows up and saves the white mustache guy with the cutlass.
And he
turns out to be our main character.
He looks like a weird French guy almost.
Yeah.
But he's not French.
He's said he was born in England.
Yeah.
And then
Portsmouth, England.
He was working on a Spanish trade ship.
Yeah. No accent, by the way.
But he doesn't say that in this scene, right?
No, he says that
way later.
But it doesn't matter. He's an American.
He's American. Okay, so he shows up and saves his life.
And then he's like,
And at this point, we're still assuming this is all happening simultaneously with the plane crash.
Who the fuck knows what you're supposed to think right now?
Yeah.
But the guy has a tattoo on his head that the mustache dude had the necklace of.
Of a turtle.
You're jumping ahead. I feel like that's it.
A time turtle?
You're talking about the daylight scene because I'm still talking about the nighttime scene.
Oh, yeah, you're talking about...
No,
sorry.
Yeah, no, remember...
talking about that beach scene.
No, I'm not talking about the beach scene.
Hold on. So
I remember the beach
they
scene
come
very
out,
distinctly.
He crashes the plane at night.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then he looks over at night and there's like this shitty samurai fight.
Yeah.
And then it cuts.
The old guy saves him and says, come with me.
Or is it just the old man?
And then it cuts back.
Then it cuts to daytime at the bar.
You're right.
No.
It can't be that because when he gets attacked, he shows the guy. He shows
during the day.
He shows him the necklace. He's
that's
like, I'm
a
looking
daylight.
For this guy.
That's a day
and he's
scene.
Like, fuck you.
It's a different scene. It's a day scene.
No, but that's why there's the fight. All right, fine.
Dude.
Who knows? I'm fine.
I can't. I seriously don't know.
I just realized something. So the. Oh. All right, jumping ahead a lot.
Who knows?
The space laser head of the company?
Don't hold on. Don't get there yet.
That's not that guy?
That was him. He's the guy he asks with the necklace, and then he goes, fuck you, I'm going to kill you, instead of telling
well,
you
so
where that
is
guy
is. So is he immortal, then?
Yes.
Yeah,
so he was immortal, too.
So he has the secret.
He's the third immortal.
Then there's got to be a sequel.
He has the secret, but he's working with the people who are looking for the secret?
Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
He was looking for the secret. It's his... Oh, my God.
But he's immortal.
Yes, it's his thing, and they stole it.
No, it's not his thing. It's the old master's thing. Okay, we'll get there. We'll get there.
All right.
Okay. I believe that then we're at... We
I
go
can't
to the
believe
bar.
We're so confused by a movie where nothing
happens. Happens.
Then
no,
it's the bar.
It's he stumbles into the bar in the morning in his timeline.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And
sits next to Mr. Clean.
Looks like he's been on fire for a couple
right.
hours. There's holes all
and
the way
down to
the
skin.
And
working at the bar is...
He looks pretty... His clothes look pretty good for being in a
plane crash
explosion.
You would think because, okay, his power is that he can heal.
Yeah.
But he still bleeds.
Yeah.
His clothes would
at
be just
first.
Covered in blood.
Yeah. And
it would be burned up.
Right.
It would have cauterized the, you know what I mean?
Or he just wouldn't look as good as he does. He looks pretty good.
All right, calm down,
because
Bob.
It's magic.
We get it. You wouldn't have sex with this guy.
I was absolutely... You wouldn't?
He seems pretty lame.
I don't fuck immortals.
He's not immortal. All right, so he's in the bar sitting next to Mr. Clean.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And he spills his drink all over the
he
guy's lap.
He orders coffee. That's when the other flashback. He orders coffee. Then there's
the daytime flashback.
Because and that's when he shows him the necklace. They get in the fight.
That's when
he
him and the master.
And he's like, what's your name? And he's like, just come with me. And he's like, but okay. All right.
But I'm looking for this dude.
And
he shows the turtle symbol.
Mm-hmm. No, he doesn't show the necklace to the fucking master. He shows it to...
Yeah, he showed it to that the skinny spear guy. Yeah.
Skinny spear guy.
Man.
Skinny spear space laser company head
yeah.
guy.
Dude.
Shiny trench coat guy.
It's kind of awesome for how boring it is.
Yeah, it's
man.
So
I mean,
boring.
Like,
I wish it
do not be fooled by how awesome we're making this movie sound.
It's not
dude,
available.
Dude, there's fucking...
From what I can tell, it's not available anywhere online, so
don't worry about
the
it.
Chance of
no,
anyone...
No, they didn't bother streaming this?
So we go back to the bar. He spills his coffee on Mr. Clean.
And he's like, you owe me an apology, well,
son. You step outside.
Well, first he was like, I think you owe me an apology. Like,
and
pretty reasonably.
They
well, and then
he
was aggressive off the bat.
He was aggro, dude. Yeah.
He was totes aggro.
Well, I guess he couldn't understand because the woman's like, what happened to you? And he was like, I was in an accident. Then he spills his coffee. And then the guy's like, I think you owe me an apology. And the guy's just like.
And he ignores him and he's like, I'm talking to you, boy.
Yeah.
And then that's when two guys in suits and the skinniest ties ever worn by men in a movie. I've never seen this tie that skinny.
They're almost shoestring. It's like,
they walk in and they're like, Urbane. So our hero's
name is
Urbane.
Urbane.
Unbelievable decision to be made.
Does he have a first name? I don't think they ever give him a first name, do they?
I think that is his first and last name.
And Bane?
Yeah.
Urbane. Ben Hur. It's like Ben Hur.
It's really Herschel Bane.
Herschel Bane.
Urbane.
Okay. So because there's also the waitress. She's important.
Yes. I guess.
No.
Isn't she the
screams.
One?
No.
She's not the same girl?
No.
No.
Man, I thought that was the same girl this whole time.
Nope. No, did she start shooting though?
Not yet.
It's one of those movies where like everyone kind of looks the same. Like I can't.
Yeah, everybody looked like 80s white
people. So the two guys come
in. There were no black people in this movie.
No, not a single
one.
Not
a single black person was in this movie.
Mm-hmm. It's a shame.
It is. I don't think they wanted to be in this movie. They were right.
No one wanted to. Okay.
Hold on. So those guys come in. They call him Urbane. He's like, I don't know who you're talking about. And they're like, you got to stop fucking with us. And the whole time, the Mr. Clean guy is like, I'm owed an apology. I'm a white male.
Yeah, right.
In a ambiguously.
I have been inconvenienced.
They never say where they are ever, which I found really interesting.
Yeah, in the United States. They're in the United
States.
They're
in the United States somewhere.
I would assume Texas.
There was a lot of forests.
Yeah, I guess.
A lot of evergreen forests, too.
A lot of office buildings.
So I'm thinking maybe Northwest America.
Yeah, I don't think even.
Washington State, maybe.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where does this stuff normally take place? Where's the most burst
anyway,
in the state?
What the fuck are we talking about?
Mr. Clean
punches
that guy, or Bane punches the other Tie guy. They pull guns.
But instantly, so they shoot at the bar.
Yeah.
And the waitress screams.
Right.
But then when they turn around,
Urbane is snuck out.
No, there's a. That's when the girl with the gun.
Yeah, the girl comes in. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The girl comes in with her gun and starts shooting.
Yeah. And they hide behind the bar. Urbane runs out with her and
He runs away alone because then she gets in her car and chases after him.
Yeah, and then the guys come out and shoot her, but she's in a fucking convertible.
Convertible, yeah. Like a Lesable. Yeah,
no one in this movie has ever trained in any firearm at all.
Ever.
Everything misses.
There's no the shooting's bad, the fighting's bad, the driving's bad.
They shoot the only gas pump and it explodes.
Yeah.
And that's why they don't chase after
That was the whole budget for the movie, by the way, was that gas tank explosion.
It was so anticlimactic. Yeah. I remember it happened. We were all just kind of like, oh, okay.
Weren't any like car crashes?
No. Nope. Just that gas pump.
Yeah.
It's so inert.
What a boring
movie. It's just inert, man.
So they get away. It shows her driving in the car. She pulls over on the side of the road to like get him to come with her.
Mm-hmm. At gunpoint.
At gunpoint. And he does. But then they're driving. He's like, why do you have the gun? She's like, you know who I am. And he's like, I don't.
Because he has amnesia from the plane crash.
Yeah, the plane crash gave him amnesia. He doesn't know who he is, so he doesn't realize.
As an audience member at this point, too, it's like.
Yeah, we have no idea.
We're like, what the fuck?
Yeah, who the fuck is he?
This is like the worst memento ever.
He seemed like a side character that is now the main character from the shittiest scene.
Yeah, hey, this was the plane pilot, for all we know. Yeah.
But he's the main character. Oh, okay.
But this is the beginning of their romance, which is just. Alternating scenes, it's alternating by the sentence.
There's no romance. It's all lust between them.
But their whole relationship.
They want to fuck. They will fuck anywhere.
But their whole relationship is, I don't trust you and I'm going to kill you.
Yeah.
Next sentence is,
now you
have
trust
to trust me and I don't understand why. And then the other person goes, fuck you, I'm going to kill you, except I want to trust you. You're just like, what the hell are you doing?
Who's doing like, what when?
It was like watching Moonlighting.
They're just constantly pulling guns and knives on each other.
Will they, won't they?
Yeah. Will they, won't they? Fuck anywhere.
And kill each other.
Was killing me.
Yeah,
the whole subplot of this movie is those two trying to find a place to fuck.
There's literally scenes
that's
where
that's the only story arc that gets any real conclusion.
There's literally scenes where there's a scene where she gives him a medical questionnaire.
Yeah.
We'll get to it, but that's literally a
Have
scene
you
like that.
Visited Africa in the last 36 months.
Yeah. You're Zika.
Yeah, you're like filling out a blood donor.
I farted. It smells horrible.
You're awesome. Thank you. Okay. Then what happens?
So they're driving. He puts the gun. She gives him the gun. He puts it in the glove box. And then he searches his pockets, finally, and finds, I don't know what the fuck he found. But he hands this thing to her and says, take me here.
Oh, he finds keys to an apartment.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, also by this time, we've met the head of the, like, they only call him the agency. I don't know what it means.
It doesn't seem like they're a government agency.
No, they can't be. It has to be private. It's Blackwater.
This guy is Blackwater. This guy is such a big
now,
part of the movie.
Now, on the box, it does say CIA.
It says CIA on the box, but
it is never said
in the movie.
Not once. They say the agency.
So he's a CIA agent head.
I guess. Shall I read?
Can I read the box for everybody?
It might help everybody.
Okay. Here's the back of the box. The description is, 300 years ago, he learned the secrets of a samurai warrior. How to fight, how to defend, and how to live forever. Trained by the master, he honed his skills for centuries as he protected the secret tablets.
That's not necessarily true at all.
Now his cover's been broken, and for the first time in his life, he must fight for his soul, battling old enemies, modern technology, and the CIA. He must protect the secret of immortality at any cost. For the sake of mankind, he has to win. None of that was in this movie.
That description is completely false.
It
has blatant lies in it. There are straight up lies in that description. He did not train under him for centuries.
It lied by saying
he
anything.
He was there for like a year at best.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
My God. Okay.
He spent
let's,
300 years
let's
in a murder
going, let's
home.
Let's keep going. Let's keep going. We gotta get through this.
Okay.
It's so hard to concentrate.
So they're in their house.
Boss lied to us.
It's his apartment. They're in his apartment. He walks in on her in a bath towel. There's no point to that scene whatsoever. You don't even see it.
What do we skip the scene where the CIA guy shows up and he's like, "What happened?" And they like lie.
Oh,
and they
yeah.
fumble. They go. The guy's like, "Did she have a gun or not?" And they both say,
"Oh
the
no, they said
twice.
They said he did he have a gun?
Oh, yeah, did he
you
have
said
a gun?
He had a
they
gun."
They don't even mention
the one guy's like, "No," and the other guy's like, "Yes." And then they both look at each other and go, "No," and the other guy says, "Yes." Yes. And then they both go, "Yes." Sorry, right, we did.
It was a comedy scene.
Yes.
It was not funny. It was terrible. It took too
And then long. They say he just disappeared.
But then they say, yeah, he just disappeared. They don't mention the girl, though. I thought that was weird. But anyway, I just want to...
Yeah.
Because then he goes, go to their apartment.
Because she's pretty significant since she's being targeted by...
You're getting
we'll
ahead.
Get to who she is.
Right.
And
but
you're just like,
now I'm backwards thinking that they should be concerned with her, too.
Yeah.
Unless they're trying to cover
well, they
for
were
her.
They were supposed
we'll
to.
Get to it.
Okay.
That doesn't... All right. Jesus Christ.
So, but he says, go to their apartment. He says, go to his apartment. Or something, right?
Yeah, something like that.
Because the apartment's where being staked out. Because when they pull up, the guys get out of the car and go, the package has arrived. There's some
yeah,
dumb
the,
shit.
Yeah, the, bird, the pigeons are in the coop.
Yeah, that's it. And you're just like, ugh. And then and that's what I thought was funny. The guy goes, he says that. Then the head guy goes, all right, we'll be over.
Yeah.
And then they go in the house, eat food, take showers.
Yeah.
Be all super awkward. They do all this stuff.
Well, he comes out and she's holding his sword, and he's like, "Hey!"
Oh my God.
And then
he says, "Hey!" And she pulls a gun out.
She drops the sword, pulls a gun out.
God, such an
awkward.
Takes
a shot, and then he's like, "What are you doing?" And then,
no, it's
what?
It's your leg clicking.
Oh, I thought it was something behind me. I'm sorry. It's like that scene.
It's cold
in here.
I gotta keep warm.
That exchange right there was a scene from this movie. What? Oh, it's his arm clicking.
Oh, no, it's his leg.
It's his leg. What?
Huh?
Oh, really? It sounded like a thing in the corner.
We need to get the tablet.
God,
right, because it just turns into like another scene within a scene. Like she's trying to kill him because she doesn't trust him all of a sudden again.
And then he's like, but why?
I don't understand. Word amnesia hasn't been said yet, right?
No, it doesn't happen.
Like,
later.
No one has
no.
assumed amnesia yet. Even though when you don't know who you are, you think.
Because then, okay,
you know,
they,
like that's your first assumption.
Do the guys get there while they're there?
Well, they once she shoots the gun, they she then is like, "Run, let's go." And he's like, "You were just trying to kill me."
Yeah,
she's
yeah,
like,
yeah.
Yeah, but it's time to go now.
Yeah.
Forget about that. That's over. It's just time to go now. Because they fired a gun, and that's when the two guys come in the building with the guns. And you're like, have they just, they showed up and just waited outside?
Yeah.
The whole time?
They wanted them to settle in.
But then the you know? Head of the agency steps up and he goes, so where are they? And he goes, no, they're like loose in the building somewhere. These conversations are so good. He's like, so where are they? They're somewhere in the building, like loose. And he's just like, but you've been watching it. And he goes, well, they didn't come out of the building. So they're in there
the guy's
somewhere.
Like, you need to be more specific with your directions.
You're just like, good Lord, what are you doing? Why are you talking? Just run in the building. You're fine. Like, you don't even.
Person,
why are you having this fucking weird ass conversation?
The director of this movie must think like when you're in a house or a building, it's just like a labyrinth.
Yeah.
Oh God.
Every building is a TARDIS.
You're just in there somewhere, man. What am I supposed to do? It's a 3-story building. They could be anywhere.
Let's just give up and move. I quit.
Oh, well, I guess we won't be immortal now.
Because this is not the only scene where a building is treated like it's enormous.
Dude, the director of this has to be super weird. Because, like, every shot outside is like, everything is huge and open and empty. And then he's like, buildings, man, they're just fucking labyrinths of hate and murder.
One of us always lies. And one of us always... It's just like, you know what I mean? It's like, riddles and shit to get to other rooms.
Oh, man. So then they go in the building to look for him, and they leave one guy, the guy who said, oh, yeah, they're in there somewhere. They left him outside, and he's, like, staring at the building more.
Because he's
like,
their
well,
finest agent.
Like, yeah. I gotta stare harder at this thing, I guess.
They're
which, by the
way,
everyone else is just wearing a sport coat, a shirt, and a tie. This guy has a 3-piece Armani suit on.
Yeah.
The dildo who didn't know they were in the building.
Well, look good though. I don't. They're in there somewhere, but
I don't know.
Fucking
and like
great.
Adjusting his collar beats me.
I was just a purple suit. Yeah. It's all velvet.
He's spinning a clock chain.
It's All right. A Technicolor dream.
Yeah, this is another one of my favorite scenes of dialogue. So that guy's staring at the building. The girl comes out from behind him, and you're like, how the fuck did they get across the street already? She smacks him in the back of the head. They run up to their car.
Which the audio wasn't timed right either. Oh, no. She swung, and right before it hit him, you heard...
Yeah.
But he... They get in the car. He gets in the driver's seat. It's her car.
Yeah. He God goes, damn it.
So
this is
he's
good.
Sitting there. Guy, this is beautiful, man.
It's such a good
he's
scene.
Sitting there, he's sitting there. He's got his hands on the steering wheel. And she goes, start the car. And he goes, I don't remember how to drive. And then she goes, well, let me do it. And he goes, no. And you're like, what is going on? He goes, I'll figure it out.
Yeah, he tells her to explain it. Yeah, tell me what to do.
Tell me what to do.
But there's and people trying to kill you.
The guy leans out the window and is like, hey! Yeah.
Dude, I wish the
goddamn
shot,
joke.
I wish the shot, like if I was making it, I wish it was a shot from the ground past them. So you just see the guy stick his head and go, hey, don't drive away.
Urbane.
Hey, Urbane.
Hey, Urbane.
Hey, there you are, Urbane. Hey, what do you forget how to drive?
You don't know how to drive a car no more?
Dude, somebody has
hey, he doesn't know how to drive!
If the Lonely Island remade Time Burst, it would be the funniest fucking movie
God
on
damn
Earth.
It. That'd be so good.
I don't know how to drive. Well, let me do it. Absolutely not! No. I'm the one driving!
Quiet, woman, I'm trying to think.
Let a man figure this out. So, when he screams his name, she's like, put the keys in the ignition! They drive away. They're getting shot at. As soon as they're away from being shot,
like,
they
no,
pull over.
Seconds of being out of range of gunfire.
They just like, all right, well, I haven't heard a gunshot in half a second. Pull over.
I guess
switch
you should
places.
Drive now.
You should probably be driving. I don't know where I
what
am
was I
or how to operate a vehicle. I guess I'll just let you. It was like, what happened?
She probably
why
nagged
him. He sat back then. He was like, oh, what was I thinking?
I'm sorry about that whole
thing. No, I got to learn.
I wanted
so
him
sorry.
To stop. Like, fine, fuck. Just get out of the car.
Let me just throw this out there, too. Amnesia is inherently a thing that makes you forget who you are,
not
but you remember things you've learned.
Yes.
He has 300 years of memories that outside of his
he's
own personal identity.
He's been driving cars since there were
yeah,
cars.
Right. He ran
yeah,
to the car.
He probably drove a Model T when it was, like, fresh.
He or maybe he has to
he
cycle.
Ran up to the car and was like, shotgun. I don't know why I said that.
Oh,
what does that mean?
Well, maybe he has to go through his memories like he's remembering who he is. He's got to remember cars. So he's like, oh, it's a Model T. And he's like sitting there looking for a button to push.
He's like, where's the crank?
Where's the joy? That'd be amazing if he's out in front like,
oh, wait, there's no thing.
Where's the horses?
Where's the choke throttle? Yeah. Like, yeah.
That'd be so good. That's what he looked like. He's like, no, I don't know.
Oh, well.
That's it.
Just him saying no is the best.
No!
No! Are you insane?
Why? Why?
I've got nothing. I have this. All right.
So they get away, right. And then they drive past a library, and he was like, hey.
Oh,
hey,
my God.
Hey. Yes, I remember that place.
And she's like, a
library?
He's like, it's important. Let's get in there.
Yeah.
What the hell
God,
is happening?
You say it out loud. It's so awesome. It seems so nuts. Like, oh, is that Billy? I remember. They're haphazardly driving God knows where.
So they go in and they just start bullshitting. And you're like, what? They broke into a library. What are you doing?
And then he has another.
You can have this conversation
dude, that's
anywhere.
Okay, that might be my favorite cut in the movie.
They have another flashback. Where
a flashback with a hard cut.
Yeah.
To him in a library, talking to the guy
the
from
CIA
the CIA.
Guy.
And I was like, is this a new scene? I didn't, personally, I was just like, well, they're in a library again. I thought like they had fell asleep and this was the next scene
there.
Or something. I was like, oh, wait. And then you said it was a flashback. I was like,
well, he asked her, he's like, so you know who I am? And she's like, you don't remember me at all, really? And he's like, no. And she's like,
we work together.
Yeah, we work together. Blah, blah, blah. She's the secretary of the CIA.
Yeah, the assistant of the CIA guy
and
who apparently knows too much about what their plan is.
On. And she was trying to extort it for money.
Yeah, so he was supposed
to
kill
not
her.
Be a secretary anymore.
But as soon as he realizes that he was supposed to kill her, he takes off fucking
well, hold on. The flashback happens.
Yeah, that's
yeah that's
and,
where
the
CIA
guy's
like
he, because he orders, She's like, we could do without her. So he's like, I'll take care of it. So
he's also telling him to go find the master. He's like, you got to find the master.
God, it's so convoluted.
For our client. He goes, so do I ever get to meet this client? And he goes, maybe. And he's like, I hate it when you're vague. And you're just like,
somebody wrote a script in which they were like, all right. They're going to just haphazardly stop at a library into which he will have a flashback.
Library
in which we'll have an exposition scene in which he is talking to the bad guy.
You know what? Cocaine. Yeah, cocaine is how this movie got made.
Or they had that one location and they were like, well, what if he's just in a library and he remembers being in a library?
Like I said, someone's like, hey, my cousin Derek said we can get into this library.
Dude, you got 3 hours before I get fired, man.
If cocaine was the reason this movie existed, there'd be something happening.
That's true.
There is more than one explosion. There would have been way more than one explosion. It was like everybody Bob said was on Valium. Like this movie,
terrible.
This is like M. Night Shyamalan directing an 80s action movie. You're just like, why is everybody just talking?
But then after the flashback, he realized he was supposed to kill her.
And his response is to run away.
Yeah, he fucking runs out to a giant parking garage.
Wasn't there to begin with.
Yeah, no. Well, he said it was connected to the library, which I think is awesome.
And he hides behind the car.
We need 100,000 cars
to be able to park. And pulls out a pocket knife and waits. And when the woman comes to find him, he fucking ganks her, like grabs her by the neck and drives and has a knife to her throat. And he was like, I was supposed to kill you, but I'm no murderer. And lets her go.
And he's like, no, you gotta do this is why you should trust me.
Yeah.
And it's like, I should trust you because you ran outside
with this man.
And
you
tricked me into putting a knife to my throat. That
her
makes
emotion.
Trust me.
You know, they say, like, if you're about to die, you're also really horny. Like, he's probably like, horn her
he's
up.
He's just
like,
keeping her on the edge. He's like, eventually.
You gotta trust me! Sticking a knife in her face.
I'm so hard right now.
I was hired to kill you. God damn it.
She's like, but what if you become yourself again? He's like, I'm a different person now.
Mm-hmm.
And then they drive somewhere.
Yeah, where did they go?
What happens after that?
This is
it
point.
Gets rough.
Didn't they drive out to the desert?
Oh, right.
Oh, okay. So she calls someone from
somewhere.
Yeah.
Who the fuck understands what happened? You're watching a car drive, but you're listening to her make a phone call to some guy and be like, meet me here at 11:30.
She calls
like,
that fat guy from Lost.
And then it cuts to the agent head and his lackeys in a van listening to them talk in the car. Mm. Not the phone conversation. Like, what the hell was going on there?
But they're in a different car,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, they stole their car. Oh, no, they didn't steal their car.
No.
That's later.
I'm just thinking because
they're
in a parking garage.
They're still in their original car right now.
Yeah.
In her car.
Oh, my God.
So what the fuck were they listening to? So now they know where they're going to meet. And that's
why weren't they listening about the library?
I don't know.
What
was being bugged?
I don't know.
What was bugged? Because
they
were
had to go
anything.
To bug her car beforehand.
Yeah.
He was in a plane crash. He didn't bug his body.
I've seen The Recruit. It might be like that. Where
you
he's
would
got
think
everything
that they
bugged.
maybe they. You would think that they would have bugged her phone. If anything, they would have just been like,
yeah,
put a
but
tap
they didn't
on
listen
her phone.
To the phone call. They listened to her tell Urbane what say you're
maybe
gonna
the
do
bug
tomorrow.
They put on
because
the phone.
Because she says the thing, and then he goes, "So you like hungry?" The dialogue in this movie is atrocious,
it's
man.
It's awesome.
What if they're listening to the man and just hear,
hey, you have a thing on your shirt.
Is it all a right. piece of food?
What'd you get
well,
that
you
shirt
could look
from?
At it yourself.
You feel
and
like at some point somebody just turned to the cameras or above the camera, like, is anyone calling the shots? Or just, are we saying anything?
The actor's like,
he just came.
The camera is like, fuck, I fell asleep.
The director's all
cooked
up.
I don't know if I'm waiting for a cut or an action now. Fuck,
this is so good. It's good
just
shit,
keep
man.
Filming it.
Oh, I love driving.
Yeah. Sure.
So do you eat food? This is a nightmare, man.
It's pretty terrible. So they're in the desert waiting because
the car.
So right now, the CIA is headed toward them.
Well, yeah, she's talking to like
Steve
Brule
pulls up.
Fat Steve Brule pulls up. We don't know who he is or why he's a thing that'll
somehow
help.
He knows.
Of all the people that could get them out of whatever situation they're in right now,
yeah.
I can't believe it's this guy in a Dr. Tommy
Steve
Bahama
Brolin.
Shirt
Dude,
and a fro.
Ill-fitting Tommy Bahama shirt.
Let me tell
shirt.
You this. That guy knew where the master was.
He did.
He knew. That guy who looked like he should be selling like pineapple smeared ham on the side of a highway. Out of a fucking half of an oil drum. You know what I mean? Like,
that guy.
He knows where the master
that
is.
That guy was in his underpants until she called him. Like, he just is like, why is this
but
dude?
But somehow he's like, knows where a fucking 400-year-old samurai
and
lives.
It's important to say the editing of this is that she's talking to him. They're in the desert. All of a sudden, two biplanes.
They're called ultralights.
Two ultralights come over the hills.
Humming over the hills.
He's Urbane is staring at him. I'm like, are you going to tell him?
He doesn't say anything.
Say that there's...
He's like, man, I wonder if I had hobbies.
Yeah. Oh, cool.
And I'm like, does no one hear the engines going off? I mean, like, they don't look.
They don't know.
See.
He doesn't look up until they go over his head.
And they shoot.
They shoot
handguns.
They shoot the fat guy to death.
He's dead.
He's the world's greatest marksman.
He doesn't say anything.
He doesn't do anything. He just says, I know everything and I can help.
And then,
bam, he's dead.
Done. And then she's like, no. And then he goes, I love this so much. There's planes shooting at them. They're hiding behind the car. She has a gun. He goes, you stay here and do nothing. I'm going to run away. And that's all that happens. He just runs through
away.
A field, and then
I thought he had a sword.
A man pulls
yeah,
up.
I thought he was gonna like leap into the air and like slice one of these
yeah,
fucking
ultralights.
Like
it.
There was a tree somewhere that
yeah.
he was gonna climb and like dive
or
out
throw
of.
The sword at it and it crashes.
None
yeah.
of this happens. None of
no.
these
he
things.
He just
happen.
Runs until he stops.
He dives down to avoid the gunshots.
The
and
CIA rape van pulls up.
Right,
they hop
yeah.
out, grab the woman, throw her in, and then that van runs over and they
do the same
him,
thing.
And
to
they
him.
Say, "We'll murder her if you put up a fight." He puts up a fight. They fucking shoot him in the chest with a shotgun.
And put him in a body bag.
Put him in a body bag.
But he's immortal. That's when we get the
flashback.
First. That's when we get the awesome beach flashback.
Oh, the
yeah.
best scene in the movie.
Where he's put up all these tents on a beach.
Dude, they're, no, they're
the
flag things.
Yeah,
there's
big, they're, like, flag wall.
It's like from Mortal Kombat, but
yes.
worse. It's worse
got,
production
like,
design than
like
Mortal
blankets
Kombat.
And shit and a little table. He's got, like, stuff. And
yeah.
he's sitting there and he's reading the tablet. And then the skinny spear laser dude shows up.
No. First, the old fat dude shows up and says, I knew you had
no,
it.
No, he shows up at the
he
end.
He shows up after.
Oh, okay.
After he's been killed.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the
matter.
Skinny spear guy
they
shows
can
up and
happen in
goes,
any order. It
yeah, it doesn't
matter.
Skinny spear guy's like, where's the master? And he's like, he's gone. And you're like, but that isn't true. But anyway, he's like, he's gone. And he's like, well... We're going to kill you because you're his buddy.
And he says
yeah.
it like that.
Then,
that's like the
yeah.
delivery. Well, we're going to kill
well,
you.
Then we're
cause...
just going to kill you then because you're here. And we're looking for him.
You're here. We love killing people. Like, okay.
When we came all this way.
We got to kill something.
Really
got to
kill.
I mean, we got three.
My man will be angry if we don't murder somebody.
Josh has been itching to murder yeah. the whole way.
So that's when they
right,
fight.
Right, Josh? Like, yeah.
They're like fighting. Urbane gets stabbed in the gut once with a spear, but then he keeps fighting, and they're like, he's
it's
not
awesome.
Human.
I was laughing so hard when he was getting stabbed.
Yeah, the fight,
yeah.
every block, like
it's
he,
no
as, every block is zoomed in just to see him gently push something away with his sword.
Yeah.
There's no music, too. It's a wide
yeah.
shot of a beach and a close-up of the
there's
blades.
There's a samurai battle on a beach in front of a bunch of flags, and there's no music.
It looks sad. It just seems
beautiful.
Sad. Yeah. It's... Oh, man.
I loved it. I kind of love this movie. I mean, it's just... Because it's so bland, it's unbelievable.
It's unbelievable.
When you write down all the key, like, hot words that this movie contains plot-wise...
And it sounds amazing.
It's so good.
Yeah. It sounds cool as shit.
It's the coolest movie ever.
This movie looks great on paper.
Like,
and honestly, those keywords, we haven't even gotten to like the coolest ones
no,
yet.
Oh, yeah.
No. Like, we still haven't gotten to the stuff that should be monumentally awesome. And it's not.
All right.
Okay.
So he gets stabbed a bunch, and then the guy thinks he's killed him, and they leave, but they don't know that the tablet's there.
Yeah.
And they just walk away. Hey, they don't look through his stuff.
It's all for anything, yeah.
Then the master shows up, and he gets up, and he's like, I'm immortal. This is crazy. It worked. And he goes, you stole my thing. You're not my student. I hate you. Also,
yeah, and he tells him, like, you'll have to live with this guilt for the rest of your days.
And
it's
he's like, okay.
Yeah, I didn't really, I'm not,
I'm
really
not feel
any guilt.
Feel
I didn't do
it.
Anything wrong.
Are you okay with it? Because
yeah.
I'm fine. Yeah, like, it's...
But we also should point out, there were many scenes, whenever the master talked, we all were like...
Is he, what is he saying?
Are those
yeah,
words?
Yeah. This guy was not phoning it in.
Love is trash. Love is trash.
Yeah.
Love is trash.
Love is trash.
Rash.
Love is rash.
Rash.
Love is rash.
R-E-S-H.
That was it. He picked up the time like,
guilt of the rest of days.
And like,
oh, okay.
The guy's like,
even the guy couldn't even understand. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, Tuesdays.
Yum. What?
So that's when he's like, you're not my student anymore. You're done. You stole from me. And that's when he wakes up in the van in the body bag and realizes he can listen to their conversation.
And the whole time he's mugging to the camera.
He literally looks at the camera like a...
Because somebody says, like, well, he's never coming back. And then he goes like...
Yeah, he looks at the camera like, we know better.
Yeah.
And then they eat sandwiches over his body.
They do. And apples.
An apple and a sandwich.
They didn't need to eat anything in that scene. No. They were just like, hey, you guys want your sandwiches?
And it was like, he like craft service table out. Break time.
He divvied them out in a weird way. We like pulled them out and he looked at them and then he was like,
I found it odd that it was.
These are for you.
These sandwiches weren't white bread. They were all rye. I don't know. It just sat weird with me.
Man. You can't, you know.
It's like, did you blow your budget for this movie on your rye bread choice?
I prefer rye, to be honest with you.
I like good white bread. Get stuck on top.
I like the idea of a man killing a man with a shotgun and then eating a sandwich immediately afterwards.
And then he eats that
good
apple
job,
all weird.
Yeah, he peeled like 80% of this apple.
And then he took skin.
All he ate was the skin and threw this apple away.
But yeah, that's what I needed.
We talked more about the apple and when it was happening than we did the scene.
The scene was stupid. It was him being like, what do you know? And she didn't know anything. So it was like, what are we talking
about? They're trying
to
find out where the master is.
Right.
Yeah, and he thinks that Urbane
told
her,
this whole time,
the
master is in a fucking room.
Doing nothing.
Doing literally nothing. Yeah. He's been doing that for centuries.
He's not actively hiding. He's just in his room.
This is a five-minute scene of a person going, what do you know? And a person who knows nothing going... How do I know you're not going to kill me for 5 minutes?
Yeah.
Like, that's all it is. And she has no leverage at all.
Well,
it's character building, Matt.
They take her and they drop her off at the villain's warehouse.
Yeah. And he gets out of the bag and starts looking at it. But then the guy's like, take him to the morgue. And he decides to, like, I guess, let them think he's dead.
Oh, my.
Then the morgue scene.
Okay.
Happens. Oh, my God.
The best scene of the movie, for real.
The morgue scene makes, you should show this at Mondo, because the morgue, there's three scenes of this movie that are so incredibly
awkward.
This
is never happening at Mondo, but that scene is great.
This scene's amazing.
It so doesn't make,
it's almost like, I wish John Turturro played the doctor so you could assume it was like a deleted scene from like Brain Donors or something. You'd be like, okay, well this scene makes complete sense because they're all maniacs.
Did you think at first when he's like taking him to the morgue, I thought they were going to take him to like the CIA morgue.
Yeah.
Like they have their own morgue.
Right.
It looks like they took him to an elementary school's basement.
Yeah. They took him to the city morgue.
Yeah. Well, they took him to a white room with six bodies on bags, 21
John
Doe's.
Number 21. So that means there's 20 unidentified bodies in the city morgue.
But we come to find out that, well.
That's so many unidentified bodies.
That's a lot of unidentified. But the one guy is identified because he eventually sees the tag.
What was his name?
Fred
Delgado.
Delbecchio?
Delgado, I think.
Delgado, yeah. Something like that. Yeah. Right, so he wakes up. He's in the morgue. He unzips. It sits up where
sees
the
doctor.
The morgue assistant.
Right.
He like winks at him or smiles.
And the guy just passes out.
So
as
he decides to put that guy in his bed.
Because he can hear people coming.
Yes.
Oh, no, even though he could just walk out of the room.
This scene was so fucking confusing to me because I had no idea. Let me tell you my thought process. This is really fucking stupid. So he puts that guy in the bag and then he pokes his head out of the hallway and the woman's crying with another doctor and her son coming down the hallway and he goes, fuck. And he goes back in the room and I'm like, okay, that's weird. Who did he recognize? Why is he worried? No one knows who he is. He could just walk out of the room and down the hallway and leave. So I was like, oh, that's someone that was... One of these three people recognizes him.
Three people
and then
that...
the following scene...
Three people that do not know about immortality.
Yeah.
At all.
Are there and can't know that he's still alive.
Five, yeah.
So he goes back in the room, gets in a different body bag. The doctor comes in, he's like, all right, look, lady. She's like crying. He's like, I don't know which one of these your son's in and my sister...
Which is great because it's a morgue guy should know where... Fucking bodies are.
Oh my god, I almost forgot about the lie.
Oh, yeah, the lie.
He's like,
I'd love to tell you where your son is, but my assistant's gone. I think he went to go get a bite. And the woman starts going, ah! And then he goes, Ta-ee! It's so crazy. You're just like, what the fuck is happening?
That is so good.
Ta-ee!
He's getting a bite of fucking your dead son.
Oh man, that's great.
Yeah, so then he's like trying to find the body. He goes, John Doe number 21, sure. He unzips where the head is. It's the feet. And then he goes, well.
And I thought, okay, so he's going to, I thought he was going to notice the shoes being like standard shoes for their
hospital.
For employee. Their vocation.
Yeah. No. Then he unzips the bag.
Whole thing.
And he looks.
There's a body wearing a lab coat.
He's wearing a lab coat with a fucking name tag. It's his assistant that he assumed that we would recognize when he walked in the room earlier. Looks him dead in the face. And he goes,
bad an eye.
That isn't your son, is it? And she's like, no. You're like, who the fuck are you? What the fuck is happening in this hospital? That's why they got 20 unknown dead bodies. Some of those people just came here to get, like, a nasal drip, and then they fucking killed him. And we're like, I don't even remember who he was. Just put him in the room.
Put him in the room. The room. Except the one guy with the name tag.
So then he goes, well, let's look at another one. He unzips the bag, the empty bag that fucking
has Urbane
in it. And the mom looks at him, goes, Freddy! Starts crying.
Yeah.
And that's, all right, so here's where I made up the stupidest thing in the world. I was like, all right, he's an immortal. He must have to, like, fake a life. So maybe he's, like, pretended to be part of this weird family or something that doesn't know that he's immortal.
That's insane.
Because she looked at him and started crying. I was like, oh, I guess he's Fred. Like Sancho or whatever.
That's
crazy. Fake family for the CIA. I was like,
can you imagine the turn the plot would have taken? It would turn out he was Fred Delgado.
My mind was racing. I know he was going on.
The CIA tricked this woman into believing she gave birth to me.
You're right. God.
I mean, that's a cover of a fucking Weekly World News.
Well, then the weird thing was, like, then her son that's still alive looks over at the bag next to the body.
And doesn't instantly freak out.
No, and it says Fred Del Becchio on it. And he's like, and then he looks over and sees Urbane, and Urbane, like, winks at him.
Yeah, and he goes,
and he runs out of the room. He doesn't even say, Mom, that's not Fred.
Yeah.
So no then one... the doctor isn't looking at Urbane. The mom
it's been an
is...
hour. We got to finish
Jesus
this up. Oh,
Jesus.
So the mom is crying. Urbane looks at her and smiles. And then she screams and leaves. And the doctor goes like, I guess that's it then. My job's over. And just walks out. You're, yeah. Like,
the guy just goes, well, I'm going to get a bite.
Yeah.
To eat!
God. That scene is just... It's mind-boggling. It's incredible.
It's like they had no clue walking in that day what they were going to shoot.
And we're not even halfway through this movie.
There's so little happens in the second half of this movie, though.
Okay.
He gets out of the hospital.
He gets to the building. He breaks in through the ceiling.
He falls in through the ceiling.
Yeah,
because his arm weighs 600 pounds.
Yeah. It looked like he got pulled in by
a stuntman fell through the window and they just left it in.
Yeah, they're like, oh, that's good shit.
Yeah, wow, that's good.
That was insane. When he hits that beam, I was like, that was weird. That looked weird and painful and awkward. Not planned.
So he falls in, finds
a box with a robot in it.
Uses that to trick.
No pertinence to the plot.
That to Home Alone.
One of the guards.
Yeah, the guy's like, ooh, and he sees the robot and he smiles. The robot has smoke coming out of it.
He taps him on the shoulder and fucking knocks him out.
Well, doesn't knock him out. He punches him repeatedly. This guy does not.
And he says some quip.
Out.
He was like, it's me again or something. Yeah. Remember, he was like trying to be funny.
So
like,
then he goes in and he sees the girl laying on the fucking couch.
Oh, jeez.
And immediately starts.
We skipped so many scenes of the girl in the building.
This building,
okay, hold on.
It looks like I said, it looks like a real estate building from a trailer park.
It's not good.
You know what it looks like?
It has like 6-foot ceilings. It seems so short.
It looks like the reception area.
Yeah.
The reception area when you go in to hear the timeshare spiel because they gave you free tickets to Busch Gardens. That's what this office looked like.
All right, so
it's just them threatening her again.
Yes, but they introduce Skinny Spear Guy in the modern time the head of the company.
And we're like, oh, it's that guy.
And now he's like the guy he hired. He hired the CIA.
That's how rich he is.
To find the
government.
I mean, that's what happened. But they introduced that. I just wanted to point that out.
Okay, so then the girl's on the couch. He finds her. She's like, oh my God, you're not dead. And he's like, that's right, baby. And then they start kissing. And then
he tries to pull her tit out.
Yeah,
he goes for a tit.
You're in the midst of the fucking lion's den.
Yeah.
And you're going to try to fuck right now.
Yeah, he's going
to. How have you lived this long? Like, you know what I mean? Like,
well, I guess when you're immortal, you don't give a fuck anymore.
Oh, I am hungry. Yeah,
I'm going to fuck.
Slake my lust.
then he has another flash where she tells him to focus. Tells him, wait, this is inappropriate right now. Yeah. Then tells him to focus, look into her eyes. He has another flashback, and now he can remember that the guy on the plane, he was there to tell him, he was making the plane seem like it was going to crash to try to
scare
the guy into telling him where the master was.
And
the guy told him,
crashed.
But then when he turned around, it was way too, he was like,
oh, shit! Which, to think about editing-wise, like, man, what? Like, you know what I mean? Like, we saw, like, the whole scene at the beginning.
Well, he might have been planning to crash that plane from the beginning anyway. You know what I mean? Because he knows he's not going to die.
There's so much shit that happened on that plane that wasn't shown in the first. Afterwards.
Right. Yeah. I'm just saying, like, when we first saw that scene, it felt like we saw the entire, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, it wasn't like we just saw, like, a piece of it and then it could have been more.
You know what's really interesting about this? We just realized the one plot point in this movie that actually makes it a story is that he randomly got amnesia from a stunt he planned to do because he knew he was immortal. That you would have to assume he's done countless times.
Dude, that's... You're right.
Because otherwise, he would have got out of that plane, murdered the woman, found the master, gotten the thing. Probably killed the master for...
Oh my God, that is... You're right. The amnesia isn't... It's an amnesia movie, honestly.
Yeah, that's the real plot of the film.
It's a Jason Bourne amnesia movie. Yeah. And...
with all his other...
Well, no. Let's not go Jason Bourne, because this guy had no skill sets that would have made him seem like he was a ninja.
No.
He couldn't punch a guy with one punch and knock him out.
He really just couldn't die. That's like his skill set, is that he can't die. That's it. Okay, so...
But that's just sad to think about.
It is. All right. So they don't... right after they don't have sex,
he remembers.
One of the guys... Well, before that, one of the guards comes in again, and he knocks that other guard out.
Yeah.
Because when he remembers the address where the master is...
Yeah, he tells her, he's at blah, 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 went for
this
lane.
Street. And then the guy on the floor, like, opens his eyes, and he's like, I've got
Boss
the address.
Gonna like live.
And then that awesome scene happens where all the villains are in a room. They walk through a door, they step into, like, frame of the shot, and then the fucking bad guy walks in and goes, oh my God, they're escaping. And then they turn around while he's saying they're behind him walking
like
out a door.
15 feet behind them.
Like, oh, there they are.
Wait a minute.
Her babe.
It's so good.
And then
man. They
take their car.
Yeah, they steal the bad guy's car.
Which is like a lightsaber.
Yeah. And they come out and they're like, go after him. He's like, they took our car. And then the one guy who was knocked down on the floor is like putting a silencer on his gun. And he's like, oh, I know where they're going.
Which is hilarious because now at this point, they've stolen their car. So it's put a hitch on them being able to get to the other place that they're all going to race to. Mm-hmm. Urbane and the woman have to get there first. However, when they do get there, they're already there with like 100 people.
Yeah.
In every room.
Well,
you're
right. When they get there, they're walking up to this house and she actually
from
breaks
the beginning.
Up.
Oh, shit. Yeah.
It's the house. No, it's the house from the beginning.
Yeah. She actually.
The conversation is awesome.
She's like, hey, back in that kidnap room. Were you gonna fuck me?
Yeah.
He was like, yeah.
Dude, do you have like all the normal parts that a man would have?
So, all right, now I want to address my other insane theory that I brought up to you guys while I watched it. That starts here. It'll get better later. But she goes, do you have all the normal parts? And I was like, what? Are there aliens or something? Like, why is she saying...
Yeah,
like,
you were going nuts with this, man.
I wanted something interesting to be going on! It was just people talking softly and awkwardly at each other. So I was like, are there aliens and shit on this planet? Because she's like, I just want to... And he's like, you can check me. And she goes, no. Like, she's afraid of finding, like, a fucking,
like, she's dealt with,
like,
it
a human with, like, a cat dick. It's this big, long, crazy spike thing. And you're like, man, maybe not. I don't think so. Amnesia or not, I ain't going near that dick.
It's weird because she's just, like, she's literally basically asking if he can, like, fuck normal and have kids normal.
It sounded like she was making sure he didn't have AIDS. Right. You know what I mean? And, like, so it was safe. I was trying to figure out if she was trying to figure out if they needed a condom. That's what it sounded like. It was weird.
During a moment in the movie where they should be rushing.
Yes. Well, then the same thing happens again where he's like, stay here. And he goes ahead, and then out of nowhere,
she gets kidnapped by a ninja.
A ninja walks up.
A normal
up and,
ninja.
Yeah, regular old die whenever you shoot at ninja.
The ninjas were confusing of what they were doing.
Well, yeah. All right, yes.
They worked for the master,
confusing.
Though,
they
right?
They worked for the master, yes. So they were, like, grabbing her so she didn't get in the shit.
They're okay. keeping her out of trouble.
Okay.
I think.
Because we're at the house from the beginning again. Okay, that's where we are in, again, just for anyone listening.
That's when,
which is just, it looked like a regular house.
It looked like a dojo in the first.
It looked like it would have had.
It's a 3-story house.
It, you walk in, split level. It has a basement and a second floor. That's about. That's right. All the house.
A minotaur lived in one of these rooms, I think, and that's what was going on. That's why it seemed to be. Because
the bad guys
endless.
Were all in there.
Yeah,
and then the
they're just in there talking to each other and planning their plan of attack in
trying
the house
to find
attacking.
The master in this house.
It's so vast that the master's.
Well, no. First, he walks in, shoots a guy.
Right.
Then sees a person sitting in a chair, and he goes, "Master." And but then Skinny Spear guy steps up.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the fucking awesome. This is the rest of my alien.
And
theory.
Then they grab him.
So they grab him they up, grab and him. He tries to fight off. And they grab him again. And then the Skinny Spear guy goes.
Didn't they shoot him again?
The wording
like, right
is
in the
insane.
Stomach, and then
they shot.
Yes, they wanted to prove that he was mortal, so they shot him
right.
in the stomach.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Then he pulls out this insane looking gun with all these things on it.
I heard
it
Tommy
looks like
was
a
like,
Nerf gun.
Who's that?
What is that gun?
He pulls out, he goes, our space department has developed a laser that can kill immortals. And the amount of questions that flooded into my head, I was just like,
you were more concerned
space
with the
station?
Space department.
Yeah. I want to know whose space department was it? Because, like,
is it NASA? Is
he's,
it government?
He owns a company, but he said ours, and he's
he
bad.
Probably
or is
meant,
it Japan?
What, his company's space exploration.
Yeah, okay, well, then it
so
brings up the question.
So that's when I was like, there are aliens.
Which is insane,
because
if you think
are aliens immortal? Is that why their space agency
no,
has
wait a minute,
space Cthulhu is happening
he
outside
was using
of this
his own company.
Atmosphere.
To develop a gun that could
kill
him.
Immortal.
Was he hiding
him.
It under...
He's
was
immortal
he,
too, right?
Was he hiding it
also
in the...
Also the master to kill the master.
Do you think he was hiding
it... I wouldn't
it?
Want a gun that could kill me. Why don't you just fucking relax and go enjoy your life?
Was
you're
he
immortal.
Just he might, what, do you think he was hiding it in the books of the space agency? Like, hey, you guys work in space. Make a gun that kills
immortal.
He kills
anything. Lasers,
shoot giant monsters out of the sky someday.
So basically, all it really is a Nerf gun with a laser pointer in it.
Question.
Yeah.
What immortal did they test it on to prove
that
it can
kill
immortals?
Well, he says something about it destroys molecules no matter what.
Yeah, but
all
you
it
think
really
he
would
have tested it out.
It
immortal,
gave him a
right.
cigar burn on his
it
arm.
Did,
that's
yeah.
really all it did. After holding it there for like 15 seconds.
He's just like, ah!
And he honestly doesn't heal right. He's not like Wolverine. It
no,
takes
yeah.
him a minute to get come back.
By the end of the movie, he still had that burn.
Oh,
yeah, that was
yeah.
permanent.
Which it's
that
like,
was pretty good continuity
that,
for
that
a
laser,
shitty movie.
That laser really should have been, like, he should have been mounted at a table, like, so he couldn't go anywhere and just turn it on and leave it
no
on for a while. Yeah.
Gold. I mean, I would think in any movie you'd have Urbane get the gun and then kill the skinny guy with it.
Oh, you would think in any movie you'd ever see that gun again?
It's amazing.
I can't believe this
something
movie,
that
man.
Nuts.
And then that call, I was like, we will never
see
that
gun
again.
never came up again. It was
you
a non-entity.
Again, but he never
yeah,
fired
he never
it again.
Shot it.
He never fired it again.
Instead, you get a more... Oh.
You know all what right, it was? All right. They were setting it
we're
up for the sequel.
There.
We're really close.
So close.
So that's when a ninja shows up. Oh, that's when the head of the CIA gets shot in the heart with an arrow.
Which
is
hilarious.
I know.
Best
really death good. In the movie.
Yeah. He gets shot in the heart, and then another two ninjas show up, and they get Urbane out of that room. Mm-hmm. And now they're loose.
In the Labyrinth house.
That's why this is great. They're loose in the building, and I'm going to use that term because every time you see Skinny Spear Laser Man from now on, he looks like he's in a command center with maps and little walkie-talkies.
No,
like, have you checked the north hallway, and you're like, this is a two-story building. Yeah. It's like 400 square feet, people. It's fucking chill out.
It's a single-family detached house.
You could hear it's people walking.
Yeah. Oh, I hear them. They're above us.
Yeah, like...
Come on. Yeah,
come on.
It's so good. But that's when you find the masters in, like, his room.
Why didn't he just take the laser gun and just start shooting it through the house? It'll cut everything off.
It destroys everything.
Yeah, just do it.
Everything as slow as it burned a hole in his arm. So it's just
kind of
like...
it's going to take fucking forever.
Just light the house on fire, then.
Was it Gilbert Grape?
Yeah, right.
All right, we've decided to Gilbert Grape this.
I think this is just a few years before
Gilbert Grape. They hadn't reached that height of thinking yet.
But so the master's in a room.
Yeah.
Just room.
So meditating.
Sitting there.
Now Urbane and, what was her name? English. Something English.
Jane English.
Jane English. Are going through there, and they both have guns. And people are popping out like it's a police training, like, thing.
Yeah, you just take
a guy
out.
Comes out, oh, CIA guy, bang, he's dead. Guy shoots out, oh, ninja, bang, he's dead too.
But no, it was like a training thing, because it was like, bad guy, bang, ninja, wait, ask it a question. It got shot by a bad guy, now it's a bad guy, bang.
Yeah, because there was like a bad ninja at one point.
We didn't know who he got shot by.
I'm pretty sure that they distracted that ninja. Like, the ninja popped out thinking he was a bad guy.
He's a shitty
ninja.
They
both look at each other, but then the other skinny Thai guy shoots
the ninja.
Oh, you
think he shot that ninja?
Because then two skinny Thais come out of the thing. I just say,
wait, guys, I made a flow chart. We see here.
Clearly, the ninja was good aligned.
I believe there was a second shooter.
The integrity of this one ninja.
It's important.
Yeah.
You know who that ninja was? That was fucking,
Mace Bacon.
Yeah, Mace Bacon. Ninja.
Mace Bacon.
He was a good man. He was a great ninja.
Yeah.
And a father.
At the end of the movie, he said, in memory of Mace Bacon.
Oh, that'd be great.
God,
he died like Jason Lee in The Crow.
Yeah.
Okay.
So in that scene,
that weird, like, oh, you're a good ninja, right?
It's like,
bang.
How depressing would it be if somebody died during the production of this? That'd be so, man.
Dude, there's so little action. If someone had died,
they would have died
of like atrophy. Like, your heart just stopped beating because they were so bored for like months on end filming this fucking movie. Some guy just died of old age because he was like staring at the Ark of the Covenant, like the filming of this movie. You watch one too many scenes of people like going like, I think it'll take care of itself. And you're just like,
he's so out of confusion.
Then they go in, they find the master, right?
Most of the house.
They're in a hallway.
Him.
You see the laser again. They're in this tight hallway, and you're like, oh, he's gonna fucking fry him with the laser. Doesn't. Urbane shoots one of his dudes.
Then the guy throws the grenade, greatest grenade toss
in the history of film.
Okay, Urbane. They're at a locked door trying to get through it. The girl's trying the door. Urbane turns. Now
he's
the guy with a space laser and like three guys behind him, right? And the girl, he shoots one of his guys. The fucking Urbane shoots one of the bad guys. The girl shoots the fucking doorknob, opens the door, and runs in. And this guy laughs. Lusterly over the bad guy's shoulder, just takes a grenade out, just puts it in his mouth, pulls the fucking pin, and
kind of like
Matthew Lillard in Dungeon Siege. He just goes,
Dude, I don't even know how to describe it. It was so lazy.
I think, like you said, like the guy was like, hey, I got a doctor's appointment after. Can I just get
I just need to throw this grenade and get out of here?
God, please. I've been here 6 hours. Like, here. It was like him throwing the prop to somebody that was standing over there.
You know what? It was like if you're at like a party or something and there's a lot of trash and you're trying not to be a slob, but then somebody goes, just put it over in the fucking stuff. And you're like sheepishly, like, awkward. Like I feel bad about tossing this in a pile. That's what the guy looked like.
The guy had regrets.
It was so nuts, and it blows up. It doesn't affect anything.
But you're supposed to think Jane blew up because he runs in the room.
But he obviously lands in a clean room. The room is empty.
Yeah.
And he's like, Jane, and I'm like, there's no body parts.
They got space lasers to melt immortals. I don't know.
Maybe they have grenades
that just vaporize things.
Space grenade. Throw a space grenade in there.
Dude, that could have been the turn of the movie, the most amazing movie ever made.
Yeah. Now you have immortal samurais. While I have an army of laser like
ninjas
soldiers
or some shit. Yeah. Laser grenades.
Okay, so
but
then
a ninja shows up and like grabs him. He's like, "Come with me," and they go back into the labyrinth. They're loose again.
The labyrinth. Maybe a stairwell.
Well, what the fuck else is it? Because they come to the master. And he's just sitting there. He's like, "Eventually, they'll find me, and I'll have to die." And you're like, "Wait a minute."
Who are you?
Trying to leave. Well, it's almost master... like people are lost here.
Oh, God.
The master
there's
has
windows.
A birthday cake.
You can see outside.
There's like a birthday cake in the corner.
Oh, yeah, the birthday cake.
Oh. It wasn't a birthday cake. It looked like a birthday cake.
It was some
cake.
Sort of like
an altar.
Altar, yeah.
But it looked like a birthday cake with four candles on it.
Yeah, yeah.
But he's in there and he goes, "This is the end for me. I'm not going to run anymore." And he's like, "But you can't let him win." And he's like, "Ah."
It's pretty
yeah, seriously, like, eh,
I'm
eh,
done.
It's been a while, eh. Don't you think this sucks? And he goes, "I mean, I was freaking out for a while, but, like, I think it was okay. Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I got amnesia.
He's
I don't know what the fuck's going on."
I got
and
a giant house with tiny rooms.
He's like, "You know what? Why don't you kill me, and then you leave? Yeah. You like to run. You keep running. I'm honest.
I've been sitting here meditating for
and they
centuries.
Say, "Well, I got nothing to live for." And he's like, "Oh, here's Jane."
And he's like, "All right, fine.
Love is rash."
Yeah, he's like, "I'll just stay and kill myself." He's like, "No, no.
Love
well,
is a rash.
Now I gotta live." And he makes her pet the Buddha statue all
yeah,
weird.
Three times. Well, he takes the tablet and he puts it on the altar, makes him sing happy birthday. And then has her pet the Buddha head three
which
times.
Opens a secret door.
Which that would not that, work.
Yeah, what yeah. technology is
oh,
that?
Oh, I forgot. Space lasers, of
right,
course.
But he doesn't have that technology.
No, hell no.
So but, a secret passage opens, tells him, you know, GTFO, kill
so this
me.
This is when Urbane goes, "You go ahead. I have something to take care of before we leave," basically.
Yeah.
Which is killing the master.
Yeah. He's like, "Hey, go get yourself all moist. I'm going to try to fuck you in this hallway. Yeah.
You
I got
escape
one thing.
And get ready for dick. I need
to
kill
to do
this fucking
the only
old
way I can
samurai.
Achieve an erection is by murdering an old Asian man."
But that scene
murdering
is
murdering the old Asian man turns him mortal that, from
well,
what
he goes,
says.
Okay, so this conversation is fucking batshit crazy.
It's nuts, yeah.
He goes, "You're immortal. I can't kill you." He tells him a story about how he killed an immortal, and he chopped his head off, and it killed him.
Yeah.
So then he doesn't chop his head off. He stabs him in the gut.
Yeah.
And then he also explains that, like, if you kill me, you'll be mortal. He just says it. It's not even an explanation. He
I
just
killed
goes,
an immortal, and
if
I
you
still
kill
was
me,
immortal,
you'll find
if you
the secret
kill me, I'll be...
to mortality. And he's like, "Oh."
Well, he says that the secret is on the tablet. You must not have read that far.
Oh, he does say he did.
Yeah,
say
but
that.
It's like
it,
a four-passage tablet.
Yeah, it has
you must
four
be
things
slow.
On it.
He's been alive for like 800.
He says 350 years.
And he didn't read the whole tablet.
The master took the tablet back when he found it and kicked him out.
But he had it back in his possession for a while. It doesn't matter. He stabs him, and it looks like he's jerking him off.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's the time
there's
burst.
Such
that's
joy.
That's the time burst that it really... His hand is down there like... Yeah.
So now the bad guys have the tablet.
So he
and a
he
space laser.
They have the tablet. They have a space laser.
They have
they
the
have
CIA
army
in their pocket.
People. They've wiped out a ninja clan that's been on Earth for 400 years trying to keep the world safe.
Well, how does that resolve?
Movie?
Oh, it doesn't resolve at all. That just leaves
no,
it open. Oh.
Just him standing there, tablet in one hand, space laser in the other, armies. No one's opposing him.
Yeah,
he can do whatever
win.
He wants. He can buy the CIA. Nothing. Nobody gives a fuck about this guy. But they never explain how he was immortal for the whole time, too.
Oh, yeah.
They never explain why he even knew the guy whose tablet was it to begin with.
Nothing. Nothing.
And it goes to that scene on them on a bluff.
That yeah. guy's
about
amazing.
Fuck.
And then he fucks her right there in a field.
And the credits roll.
Well, hold on. He fucks her in the field. The camera pans over, and there is
oh.
maybe the ghost of
the
old Asian guy.
Oh, love is rich. Rub his ring. Rubbing his
jerking off. Holding a fish tank with yeah. dead fish.
Like, the evil got away. They
yeah,
won.
Evil won. Bad
evil
guy,
won
evil wins.
Day.
Because this guy just wanted to fuck.
I told you, the only story resolution is him trying to fuck her wherever
you're
he
right.
could.
You're right. That is the story. It's yeah. a guy trying to get laid.
It's an immortal guy
it's
just
insane.
Trying to fuck a chick.
It's
fuck
a
chick in mom jeans. That's all
they
it's
really
about.
Do
it's
get away.
It's a guy. They say earlier, she goes, "You know, you asked me out before you forgot who you were." And he's like, "Oh, yeah, really? How'd it go?" And she's like, "I said no." And he's like, "Why?" And she's like, "Because you were a dick." And he's like, "Well, it's not me anymore." This movie is about a guy with amnesia. It's like reverse while you were sleeping. It's like this movie is like a romantic.
While you were sleeping.
It's a movie about a guy who tried to be with a girl. She didn't like him. Then he forgot who he was. And she was like, you're actually pretty cool. And then they get together and are happy and fuck.
There's just all this ninja space laser horseshit happens.
Yeah. All that does. You don't need any of that.
300-year-old ninjas with space laser academies.
He gave up his immortality at a moment when they were when the bad guy was completely winning.
Yeah.
He didn't go and fix everything and while then, he was still immortal.
He's like, you know what? Why don't I try to kill everybody? And then if you really want to die, I'll kill you.
He's so selfish that he actually was like, well, I don't want to go help because that space laser could kill me too. It's like, dude, you've lived for like 350 years. I think you dying now will be fine.
Yeah, go ahead.
You know what I mean? Like, how selfish are you? You've had like eight lifetimes, dude.
You're right.
And he was nuts. Like, she's like, I could die. And he's like, well, I could die. Why are you thinking about me for a change?
Yeah. Hey, they have a laser that could kill me too, eventually.
She didn't, I love it. I love that she
very slowly, but it'll get
I love that she didn't say, the laser could kill me too. let's be very clear. The laser kills literally everything.
Oh, my God. What if it didn't work on normal people?
That'd be amazing.
Yeah, he becomes, I actually
it literally
thought,
only
when he was immortal. Yeah. The laser can't hurt him.
The guy's like, "Hi, you fool! You stepped right in my trap."
And they
nothing.
Pulls,
oh my god, you're immortal! I'm so scared.
And then he holds out a mirror and shoots the beam back at the guy.
He gets a mirror from her purse or something.
Oh, we just fixed this movie, guys.
That'd be amazing. He's rooting around in her purse for the mayor, and he pulls out and is like a condom with it. And he goes, "Well, we'll save this."
A Magnum, fuck.
It's a lot to live up to.
God, you're so right. I can't believe the ending is.
Evil wins.
This movie's and that weird.
Kids, you were so excited about this.
And that kids is how our Lord and Emperor God King got created.
Dude, this movie is so nothing. It's ridiculous.
this is the autobiography of King Jong Il. Like, this is how he became the immortal king of North Korea.
Dude, if you just name the master Kim Jong Il, this movie becomes amazing. Holy shit!
What a boring ass movie. Full of really cool, interesting stuff.
After we're done this, I'm gonna look up to make sure this isn't like the fifth sequel or something.
There's
like, I feel
no
like we should have known more. Things.
There's no way there's more than one.
It definitely feels like it was like the fifth or sixth in a series where they're not trying anymore.
Well, it says the final alliance. Maybe there was an alliance.
Maybe.
Almost allianced.
Who allied?
No one.
No one.
He kicked him out of being a student. Him and her.
There were no alliances.
The final alliance is PIV, missionary sex in the woods.
All I know is I want to.
That is the final
alliance. I personally would love to time travel back to a time when you could release a movie like this in a store and there's no internet. So people just will haphazardly take this thing and the whole family sits down.
You know what? You sneak it onto the employee's choice shelf.
Time Burst. Ooh.
Ooh, that looks so fun, right?
He
guys?
Almost looks like Jean-Claude Van Damme, and that I've seen that guy be
Ma!
A
whole
dude, the box straight up
dude,
lies to you.
At
on the
one
back
point,
of it.
This video was a couple families' Friday nights. Like they all sat down to have a really
also,
great family night.
She never wears this outfit.
No.
She's wearing
a mini skirt. Yeah, she's wearing mom jeans the whole time.
Time Burst doesn't even make sense as a title.
Oh, she also was Aubrey Plaza, basically.
Oh, yeah.
The way she delivered her lines, she looked like her. It was weird.
All right. Time Burst, if you can find this thing and you really...
Don't watch it.
Yeah, avoid it.
I implore you to find it so you can't...
You can do...
Watch the morgue scene.
You can smash your nuts with a hammer and get more enjoyment out of your time.
I think they should watch the morgue scene.
All right, we have to at least give this to Mark to like cut out the morgue scene for like a compilation thing.
Yeah.
Because it's so...
Well, and the car driving scene. You need the car driving scene, the morgue
scene,
and the grenade toss.
Yes. Yeah. Those three. That's the movie right there. That's a great short film. Time Burst, the final short film. That's God damn.
What a boring ass.
Thanks, Tommy,
movie.
For watching this nothing.
Thanks, I'll make sure to recommend all my friends to come and be on this podcast.
Better stuff.
We've watched.
No, I had a great time.
Brian Preston watched Brick Mansions. That's a great movie.
Yeah.
Dude, Brick Mansions opens so many doors to discussion. It's beautiful.
It's a work of art.
Yeah. There's plot holes you could spend your whole life delving into in that movie.
I enjoy a good bad movie, but this was not a good bad movie.
No, it's not
so you
fun.
You wouldn't recommend this?
No. To who? Who would I recommend it to?
If somebody was into this type of thing, sure.
But I actually, because of all the, like, if I recommend this to someone, I was just dressing these tomatoes kind of shit, is like, yeah. I love it. Like,
if I recommend this to someone, they wouldn't trust my recommendations anymore.
I don't think anyone's trusting me and Matt at this point anyway. Yeah. So on this podcast, we've watched way too many things that are, this is maybe one of the most inexplicable.
It's unbelievably
boring. This is like 46 or 7 episodes in.
The fucking, that 3-movie trailer in the front was worlds better than this movie.
It was. And we were going to.
If you guys watch Saxman, I'll be back for Saxman.
You want to come back
for Saxman.
All right. Tommy Sinbazo, Saxman. That's the future bonus disc. All right. We're done. It's time burst out of here.
Wait, can I plug my podcast?
Yeah, plug.
Check out LaughFinder Podcast. We're Baltimore comedians and a guest play Pathfinder. It's laughfinderpod.com.
And it's all in Thundergrunt.
It's Thundergrunt.
It's on the same.
It's all brand synergy.
Yeah, right. Synergy. Mm-hmm. Listen to that. And meanwhile, the Skull Base.
Meanwhile, yeah, that's coming out soon. Real soon.
Season 3, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Thanks, Tommy.
Thank you, guys. Thanks for having me.
Let's go watch 7 Evil Bong movies, Bob.
Yeah! On Instant Screaming, also on Thundergrind. All right, bye.
You have just listened to Bonus Disc. Questions, comments, and movie suggestions can be posted to facebook.com/bonusdisc. Opinions and criticisms of the hosts and guests of Bonus Disc are 100% valid because they sit high atop Judgment Mountain. So quit your whining!